get bigger.
Sabah khair. Assalamu alaikum. Good morning to you all. My name is Ibrahim Sbeih, and we are transmitting live here from Amman, Jordan, at the Farah Medical Campus. And the backdrop is the Dead Sea, which is the lowest point on Earth, where you can just float on the surface of water. We are presenting a tuberous sclerosis case and correlate the clinical, radiological, operative, and pathological findings. Tuberous sclerosis, which is a disease, a complex disease, was first described by von Recklinghausen, you know von Recklinghausen of the neurofibromatosis, back in 1862, and Bourneville followed 1880. These were the first description of this disease. This is von Recklinghausen. He is a German pathologist, and he just noticed a fetus who was just born, who died later, within a few minutes, and he examined him and he found that he has brain tumors and other tumors. So he coined that name. Followed by this French man, French neurologist, post-mortem, and he found that she has a brain tumor. And then this man, Vogt, a German neurologist, 1908, who gave the classical triad to this disease. Patients who would have epilepsy, mental retardation, and have something on their face called adenoma sebaceum. So this is the first description of the triad. And this disease occurred in 1 in 10,000 live births. It is autosomal dominant genetic disorder. Either the father or the mother would be carrying the disease, and they will transmit it to half of their children, boys or girls. Just to say that around the world, there's something like 2 to 5 million people in the world with tuberous sclerosis. What is the pathology? What is the cause of this disease? It's a genetic problem, so we have two genes that are responsible for normal functioning of the cell. These genes, they have a mutation, and this mutation will lead, without going into much details, this is certain pathway that will lead to eventually the cell growth and division. This pathway is freed, and therefore lots of cells are formed as a tumor. So these genes act as tumor suppressor, and when they are mutated, they are gone. Tumors would develop. These chromosomes are chromosome 9 and 16. Each one of them is responsible for a certain protein formation. This absence of genes lead to the activation of the pathway which I just mentioned, leading to proliferation and formation of tumors or hamartomas. So what will this result in? This will result in some derangement of the cortex, cerebral cortex, during fetal life. This is normal cerebral cortex of mine and yours, made of 6 layers, well organized. Here, disarray of these layers, they are disorganized. There's no good cerebral cortex. This is normal cerebral cortex, certain arrangements. This is not arranged. This is derranged, disorganized. And if you look into these cortices, you will find abnormal cells that they are not normally there. Dysmorphic neurons, balloon cells, these are not normally in the cortex. So that would lead to formation of something called tubers, tubers-like masses or sclerosis. This could be in the cortex or just underneath the cortex or in the white matter. And they occur in 90 to 100% of patients with this disease. What do I mean by tubers? Look at this. These are called tubers in the cortex. Look at this, tubers in the cortex. Again, all these denote either cortical or subcortical or even white matter tubules. Again here. And this may calcify. The second thing that can happen is that underneath the ependema, there will be some nodules. We call them subependymal nodules, SEN, subependymal nodules. Again, they occur in 90 to 100% of patients with tuberous sclerosis. Look at these tubules, nodules. Here they are. Why do they occur in this area? It is unclear why they are inside the ventricle, under the ependema, and surrounding the foramen of Monroe. So people thought about it. This is the putamen. We are from lateral to medial putamen, and then we have the other areas of the basal ganglia, and then we have the thalamus. So putamen and globus pallidus, then thalamus, and then we have the caudate nucleus. So caudate nucleus has a head, body, and the tail. Head, body, and the tail. It seems that the tumors, they organize themselves around the caudate nucleus. So if you look at the MRI or CT, you will find that you will see the caudate nucleus in all the cuts. Amazingly, that these lesions occur along the caudate nucleus. Somebody thought about this, and this paper, very interesting paper from New York, they found that these really tumors arrange themselves around the caudate nucleus, mostly around foramen of Monroe. Again here, look, exactly where the caudate nucleus is. Here you are. Nodules underneath the ependema, they may calcify, but just concentrating around the foramen of Monroe.
Any other locations in the body due to the actual loss of this?
Yes, we'll come to that, yes. So this is a picture that says it all. The cortical, subcortical nodules, the subependymal nodules, and the so-called migration line. So this simplifies exactly what we will see in these diseases. As I said, they may calcify like this. And then it's important to know what's the differential diagnosis of this calcification. The third thing that happened, so we spoke about the cortical, subcortical nodules, we spoke about the subependymal nodules, and from these subependymal nodules may develop SIGA. SIGA, abbreviation of subependymal giant cell astrocytoma, a very special type of tumors that happens only in tuberous sclerosis. So they develop from these subependymal nodules. Do they occur in all patients? No, just about 5 to 20% of patients. And we see them around this age. So SIGA, subependymal giant cell astrocytoma, is a benign tumor, is WHO grade 1 tumor. And as you can see here, CT scan appearances, look at this here. The whole disease, the cortical lesions, the subependymal lesions, the white matter disease. And this is the MRI T1 with contrast. They take contrast very well because they are very vascular. And this is the flare, again showing these lesions. So flare showing you the lesions. The whole story is there. Different types of series. This is my series. And they can progress. So this is a paper which describes this progression of the disease, how they progress slowly by time. All of them, they grow, but at a different pace. So they could be giant, like this. They could be smaller. But notice that they are centered around foramen of Monroe. So the main presentation is blockage of CSF and hydrocephalus. And this is the calcification that you may see on MRI. They can bleed. So this is a tumor which is vascular that can present with acute hemorrhage. And remember, we presented here the pituitary apoplexy, so one would think of pituitary apoplexy in these cases. What is the role of PET scan? This is the cortical tubers, and this is the PET scan showing it as decreased activity. So PET scan has a role also. FDG beta in particular, you can see hypometabolism in that area. And when you combine both, you can put this on this and come out with this. So this will define to you where is the lesion. Again, area of hypometabolism on the FDG PET here, which is corresponding to this. Here it is there. And when you put them together, you find this picture. Not only that, you see the lesion better, but our neurologists are all here today. Tuberous sclerosis present with epilepsy, and then you treat them with medication. Usually they are resistant, so you may go for surgery for epilepsy. Which one of these you want to remove? Which one is the epileptogenic area? So this FDG PET would help you, because there is this area of hypometabolism, which is not corresponding to the size of this, so it is considered as the culprit, and surgery there may help these patients. Again, the same thing here, hypometabolism, so you may think that this is the culprit for epilepsy as a focus. Different views, MRI is normal, but the PET shows this hypometabolism, and you can tell that this is the lesion. And then you can put the subdural grids and treat it surgically. SPECT, another type of modality, whereby you can see it as hypermetabolism, hyperperfusion actually. It is dealing with the how much blood there is. So it can show you the lesion. There it is on MRI, there it is on the SPECT, and then you fuse them together. Here's the MRI, here's the SPECT, which is fused, and you can see the lesion and the hypometabolic area. So FDG PET is useful in these cases, not for diagnosis only, but for defining the epileptogenic focus. Any other manifestations, Marwan, for the disease? Yes. Ophthalmological, and happens in half of the patients. They are either retinal hematomas or flat or nodular, and depigmentation. These are retinal hematomas. Our ophthalmologist here would appreciate these lesions. Different types of hematomas.
They come either or they come hand in hand?
50% of patients may develop these. 50% have these ophthalmological changes. So again, this paper, very interesting paper about the OCT in these hematomas. So this is a hematoma, and this is the OCT, and you can see the lesion. Same here. Here, because it's big, it's coming up like this. So OCT is important in this regard. Any other manifestations? Yes. I'll just have some water. I had a heavy breakfast this morning. So dermatological, and this is important, 90% of patients, 90%. And you start with children. So this is why we invited our colleagues, the pediatricians, because it's their duty to discover these cases. And our pediatric neurologists and adult neurologists are here. And the general practitioners are of great importance to diagnose this disease. These lesions are disfiguring, distressful, and painful for those kids. So this is a very important thing. Cutaneous manifestation of tuberous sclerosis and the pediatrician and the general practitioner role. This is the main presentation. Adenomasipation. It is not adenomasipation. Acne vulgaris. it is actual angiofibromas. Lots of blood vessels in it. It's red papules containing blood vessels. Once you did this, this is 90% tuberous sclerosis. Different kinds of them. They can be very severe. But the diagnosis is there. And something else is these spots, white spots that looks like these leaves. That's why it's called ash leaf spots. Hypopigmentation. They have this flat, like the orange peel, on the skin, big areas like this, called chagrin patch. They have this, gingival fibroma. Look at this. And the distorted teeth, fibroma. They have these plaques on the face. It's called face plaques. They have this, very unusual. How many of us examine the nails and the toes of your patients? Very few, but you see these. And the toes or on the fingers, but mostly in the toes, you clinch the diagnosis. So 90% of your patients with tuberous sclerosis have these skin manifestations. They can come up with cardiac manifestations, cardiac rhabdomyomas, large ones. These are pictures, giant fetal rhabdomyoma, left ventricle, and multiple. They can also go to the lungs, and they present with the LAM. LAM is lymphangio leiomyosarcoma, like this, like this, like this. Again, LAM, pulmonary leiomyosarcoma. They can affect the kidneys. Kidneys are the most important ones that are affected usually. 50 to 80% of patients. And they come also with tumors, angiolipomas, or polycystic kidney disease. And some people thought, why polycystic kidney disease? They have polycystic disease also as a genetic disease. What is the relation? Because the chromosomes are close together, so they can dentate each other. So either angiomyolipoma, or polycystic kidney, or renal cell carcinoma. Here you are. It could be unilateral, it could be bilateral. Tumors of the kidneys. Renal cysts, polycystic disease of the kidneys. Or you come up with renal carcinoma. So tuberous sclerosis complex because it affects so many systems in the body, including the brain. It can also affect the liver with either cysts or with the tumors, angiolipomas. So what's the clinical picture? We described it almost, but mostly these three lines. Developmental delay, a child who's not developing well at school, maybe they present with autism, and definitely with epilepsy. So how to find a definite diagnosis? You need to find two major features or two major with one minor. The major ones which I described, the facial thing, facial angiofibroma, the subangual fibroma, the chagrin patch, any of these considered as a primary criteria. Add to these, if you find something in the brain like tubers or subependymal nodules and anything else, then you will clinch the diagnosis. The secondary features, you need two of these plus one of the primary, anything in the kidneys like polycystic kidney or pulmonary or cardiac. And of course, you will get the genetic testing. And you have to assess your patients from the neuropsychological point of view. We invited Dr. Walid Sarhan. Is he around? No. You are here. Okay, thank you. So we'll come back to you. So what is the treatment of these? Treatment options of SIGA. SIGA because it's the tumor that develops in these patients. If you find calcification, you will leave it. Mental retardation, you will treat the aspects of it. Epilepsy, you will treat it with anti-epileptic drugs. But what about these tumors, the SIGA, subependymal giant astrocytoma? Surgery is the standard. I will come to a new pharmacotherapy, I'll come to the radiation therapy and the stereotactic radiation. So surgery, in addition to surgery, you have endoscopic surgery, either open surgery or endoscopic surgery, just the same. Radiotherapy, in a nutshell, outcomes are very disappointing. These tumors are not radio resistant. Simple as that. So people came up with another radiation, laser interstitial thermal therapy, LET. It is MRI guided. It's said that it destroys the tissues by using heat. Whether that is correct or not, we don't know. But there are papers which say something. This is one of the papers saying that this is the lesion before treatment and this is after treatment. So they claim they were successful. Another case, they got the tumor reduced in size. Laser interstitial thermal therapy. Some people use gamma knife. Very, very unsuccessful. And there is uncertainty in efficacy and there is nothing. The major center in America is in Pittsburgh. The major center in Europe is in Sweden. And this is in Pittsburgh. Over 20 years, they have just treated 5 patients or 6 patients. Now, this is the medical treatment. Remember we said about this pathway? This is the normal pathway that allows the cell to function and to divide. If you do mutation, and the genes are gone, this is free to divide so much, so you'll have tumors. So if you give a drug that will stop and inhibit this pathway, then you may get the tumor less. So this is the drug, everolimus and tismolimus. They are FDA approved in the States and in Europe. It's an oral drug, 3 milligrams per square meter per day, and then you titrate the concentration. The problem is that you have to continue this medication all life, and there are lots of side effects.
Is this for anti-rejection purposes as well?
Sorry?
Anti-rejection medications?
I don't know about other uses, but they are used as such for this pathway. Yes, as anti-cancer. So there are some papers which describe this medical treatment. This is the subependymal use that developed into the SIGA, the tumor, subependymal giant astrocytoma, and they have given it this medication, and it seems to be less. Another case, getting less. This is 3 months, this is 36 months. Stop the medication, the tumor will grow back. Another series with this tumor being treated. So how successful is this? I don't know. But as I said, the main thing that you have to continue with it, you stop it, the tumor will come back. Now we'll come to our case presentation related to the subject. This is an 18-year-old girl, female. She's Palestinian, residing in Saudi Arabia. Very unlucky. She came to us last year with headaches, nausea, vomiting, and blurring vision. These three, for the young residents, increased intracranial pressure. She had also imbalance, and she had seizures. So, major problem. What about past history? Oh yes, she was epileptic since she was at the age of 2. Epilepsy started at the age of 2. Nobody got the answer to why she would have epilepsy. Anyway, this is her vital signs on arrival to Jordan, end of last year. Nothing unusual in her general examination. Glasscom scale, good. She had cerebellar signs, imbalance. Her gait was unsteady. No weaknesses in her upper or lower limbs. The only thing in her lab is just a little bit elevated of white BCs. Other than that, everything was normal. So at that time, we looked into her images. Let's see the images that she had at the age of 2, when she had seizures and she was put on Tegretol. Here they are, normal. But having a normal CT or MRI doesn't mean the end of the story. So nothing in the MRI of 2002 in Saudi Arabia. We also requested other images. So I said, yes, at the age of 7 years, she had also seizures and she had another MRI. But all the time she had poor school performance, epilepsy, mental retardation. They should have thought, of tuberous sclerosis. They didn't. That's how it is. So these are two times. There is a tumor. There is a lesion there. So, it's, you know, just 1 + 1 = 2. This should clinch the diagnosis. They didn't. So the 2017. Then, repeatedly having epilepsy. So in Saudi Arabia, she had also this MRI, which showed that the lesion is bigger, much bigger. No red flags, no bells ringing. They are in deep sleep. So she came to us in November 2017. Skull X-ray tells you the diagnosis. This is so-called silver beaten appearance. This is a chronic increased intracranial pressure. The convolutions of the brain are hitting against the skull and they cause these changes. Chest X-ray was within normal, some infiltration there. But look at this, large tumor obstructing the foramen of Monroe and a huge hydrocephalus. So this is the MRI of November 2017, which I showed you the essence of it. The MRA just showing in the lateral view the arching of the vessels due to hydrocephalus. Again, cuts from the coronal sections of this tumor, both right and left, but this side on the left is more calcified than the others. Large part on the right, small part calcified on the left. But nevertheless, it's obstructing foramen of Monroe completely, causing severe hydrocephalus. This is November 17. This is the sagittal view. Totally obstructing the foramen of Monroe and going downwards into the third ventricle. Of course, this is vein of Galen, this is straight sinus. The rest of the MRI. So what's the differential diagnosis of this when you see it? Suppose you just see the MRI. You don't know about the patient. Would you diagnose tuberous sclerosis or would you diagnose something else? Let's see. Ependymoma, of course. This is intraventricular tumor. And the commonest intraventricular tumor is ependymoma. And look at this. It looks very much like our case, this particular. So ependymoma, why not? Sub-ependymoma, another thing. Ependymoma, sub-ependymoma, sub-ependymal giant astrocytoma, three different cells. Sub-ependymoma, inside the ventricle. Of course, the topic of today is the sub-ependymal giant astrocytoma. Astrocytomas in general, not sub-ependymal, but astrocytoma grade 1, grade 2, 3, 4. Astrocytomas of different grades can present into the ventricle. A glioblastoma multiforme, JBM, also can be inside the ventricle. Oligodendroglioma, another astrocytoma, another glioma can also develop in that area. These are all my cases. Neurocytoma, I have a big collection of these intraventricular tumors, and this is one of the largest intraventricular tumors. Neurocytoma, okay. Again, they love this area, they love the area of the foramen of Monroe. Foramen of Monroe is very dearly beloved for one reason. Maybe people think it's a female. Coronal plexus lesions, whether it is papilloma, atypical papilloma, or even carcinoma, the three types of coronal plexus tumors. Germinoma, this is one of my cases in this Iraqi girl. PNET, primary neuroectodermal tumor, very much like our case. Colloid cyst, foramen of Monroe, again one of the commonest lesions. Again, this is one of the largest colloid cysts in literature, one of mine from Yemen. Intraventricular teratoma. Oh, intraventricular teratoma inside the ventricle, yes, it can happen. That's what I'm saying always, that if you can just think of one or two pathologies, you are lost. You are lost as a human being and as a doctor. Ganglion neuroblastoma. Giant aneurysm. Imagine this as a giant aneurysm. Yes, why not? giant aneurysm of the internal carotid and its branches. You open it, you are done, patient is done. Intraventricular meningioma. In the risk category of intraventricular meningioma, I say, well, meningioma occur from the dura arachnoid. We say no. Meningioma arises from the arachnoid, whether it is around or inside the ventricle, because there is arachnoid inside the ventricle, the so-called choroid plexus. So this intraventricular tumor can occur in anywhere, but especially in the left atrium of the lateral ventricle, very rarely at the foramen of Monroe, but this is one of my cases. Metastasis, again, metastasis inside the ventricle, metastasis in the pituitary, yes. Metastasis, they are choosy, they go wherever they want. Corpus callosum lipoma. Intracranial tuberculoma, intra-ventricular tuberculoma, especially in Yemeni patients, Sudanese. Neurocystosarcosis, Montasar is not here, but he would have loved this to see this. This is a neurocystosarcosis, why not? Again, because you don't read and you come to just this small piece of knowledge and you continue all your life with this small piece of knowledge. Oh, this is gastritis, this is appendicitis, this kind of itis thing, and then you're lost. Lymphoma. Would you believe this? This is a lymphoma in this Iraqi, in this Syrian patient. And look at the year. Myself and Ala Adasi, we had 7 patients of lymphomas. Now calcification. We said these lesions calcify. So what is the differential diagnosis of this calcification? There is something called normal physiological calcification that we see in the basal ganglia. This is normal. But there are calcifications related to hyperparathyroidism. This is pathological calcification. Calcification related to influenza, to malaria, to HIV, to toxoplasmosis. That's why they produce this term TORCH, toxoplasma, and so on and so forth, to describe the group of diseases that cause this calcification. This is calcification for one reason. It is there. So, we got this patient in, as we are investigating. Hello, hello, patient is unconscious, fixed dilated pupils. I went there to her room. Indeed, she was flat, unconscious, and her right pupil was fixed, dilated. So, we knew this is due to hydrocephalus, and then took her to theater, and I put external ventricular drain. I did not put a shunt. Shunt is a disease in itself, and it is used by the mediocre surgeons to solve their problems. Anything is treated with shunt. A good shunt is no shunt. Everybody says this, but in the third world countries, shunt is what the mediocre surgeons have in their hands. They treat everything with a shunt.
What's the difference between external ventricular
drain? External drain is temporary. You put it into the ventricle, you drain CSF out. You save the patient life. Shunt is inside shunt. It stays. If I have a boy or a girl with hydrocephalus, I would not love you to put a shunt in them because they would live a miserable life. So, that's the external ventricular drain. And for the nurses here, we will give you some lectures about how to handle this, because this is can cause the patient to lose her life or her life if it is not handled properly. This is a drain for the ventricle. You don't put it on the floor. You don't put it with the gravity, because you do this, all of the CSF will go to the drain and patient would die. Did we have death due to external ventricular drain in Jordan? So many. So many.
The arrests have been because of coning, you think?
Yes. The CSF goes, the ventricles collapse, the brain collapse, yes. Hemorrhage, death.
Why you don't do the epidural? You extract fluid.
That wouldn't do. If you do lumbar puncture in these cases, they would die out of herniation. In fact, it is completely contraindication. So, of course, we put the drain. Here it is, frontal. So we drain CSF, we save the patient's life. She recovered immediately. On table, her pupil started to act. This is a crime. bilateral shunt to treat this tumor. You know, the criminal surgeon has no idea how to operate. So he resorts to what he knows, the shunt, to what he was trained for, shunt. And I always say, you ask somebody, give me your logbook of surgery. Oh, I have done 300 cases. Let me see. 299 are shunts and revisions of shunts. And this man or woman will be certified as a neurosurgeon, and he will be free to kill patients. So we did a few consultations. We asked Dr. Waleed Sarhan and his team, would you like to comment, or should I? Okay. I'm sorry, I forgot your name. Ala Bishtawi. She is a psychologist with Dr. Waleed Sarhan. Why did we ask Dr. Waleed? We asked them, in most of the cases of brain tumors, this is the standard in any good unit, that they should have psychological analysis, especially in tuberous sclerosis, where they have mental retardation. So we asked them to do Karnofsky Performance Scale, KPS, which is very important. And it's 50. It's very low. This is critical, because this patient is going to take care of herself after surgery. Her IQ was very low, 60. So this is important to assist the patient before surgery. So I always put what has been written, so that if anybody denies, I say, here it is. We asked Dr. Ibrahim Sadat, is he around? Yes.
Good morning. So as you saw in the images, there is a lesion that is causing increased intracranial pressure, and with this we expect, if it is a long-standing, we expect papilledema. So that was the case. And in a lot of cases of papilledema, the vision is not affected until late in the disease. So the vision is still good, 0.8 in the right, 1 in the left. If the disease is equal, there will be no differences in the pupillary response. So there is no afferent pupillary defect. And obviously, if the fundoscopy showed bilateral optic disc swelling, we say optic disc is swelling if we don't know the cause. But in obvious cases like this, we are 100% sure that it is secondary to increased intracranial pressure. So we call it papilledema. Motility is full in both eyes. This is not the case in many cases like this, because the sixth and other cranial nerves, motor nerves, are affected. Visual field, there is non-specific changes in the visual field, because with papilledema, sometimes we see increased or enlarged blind spot, but many times we don't see a specific pattern for the disease. Thank you.
So this patient had hydrocephalus and papilledema, and she lost consciousness because of hydrocephalus. Hydrocephalus can kill. It can maim. People take hydrocephalus easily. It's a fatal disease if it is not treated appropriately. We got the consent. The consent, we have spoke about it so many times. It has to be details. It's specific for that particular patient, not for any patient. حول أطباء المستشفى الإجراء اللازم كلام فاضي. It does not stand in court. It does not stand in medicine. It does not stand in ethics. Which way to go? Either I would go between the two hemispheres, the so-called the transcalosal, because I cross the corpus callosum like this, or I go this way through the brain into the ventricle. So transventricular or transcalosal. Depends on the many factors. I choose to do this through transcortical. So you come and put your flap just in front, a little back, two-thirds in front, one-third in the back, and you open the bone here, like this one, like this one. This is the midline. We may use navigation to make sure that we are in the right spot. Again, navigation or for the beginners, or training, not for me. If I don't know where I am, I should not be doing the surgery. Navigation confirms that I am in the right place, confirms. So I want to go to the foramen of Monroe. This is the lateral ventricle, anterior horn, body, atrium, occipital horn, temporal horn, from the lateral ventricle through foramen of Monroe into the third ventricle. This is the roof, the posterior wall, the floor, the anterior wall of the third ventricle. This is the adhesions between the two thalami, massa media. This is where the pineal gland is. And this is aqueduct of Servius, fourth ventricle, lateral opening of Lushka, median of Magendie, and then the spinal canal. So I want to go there. There, foramen of Monroe. There are two foramini of Monroe, one on each side. So if I look at the ventricles from above, ventricle on the right, ventricle on the left, there is septum bellosidum or lucidum between the two. This is the caudate nucleus, and this is the thalamus, and this is called the caudate thalamic fissure, where the thalamo-striate vein lies. So magnified view, right ventricle, left ventricle, the septum between the two, foramen of Monroe right, foramen of Monroe left. This is the thalamus striate between the thalamus and the caudate, the thalamus striate between the thalamus and the caudate. Look at the caudate, it's large, and the tumors would love this area. So when you come close, the septal vein, the thalamus striate vein, they join together to form the internal cerebral vein. So one is the column of the fornix, important for memory, for psychological assessment. The column of the fornix, this is the body of the fornix, is important. It's part of the limbic system. It's extremely important. People, they lose the memory completely because of surgery in this area. So this, the column of the fornix, is very important. Septal vein is very important. Most important is the thalamus striate vein. Damage it, patient will have infarction, hemiplegia, and most likely will die. So we are going to operate in this critical area. That's why the mediocre surgeons go for the shunt, because they don't know this. So he knows he cannot operate on this patient. So put a shunt and send him for radiotherapy. Let's see the surgery. Again, I went through the cortex on the right side, made an opening. I am now inside the ventricle. The minute I touch the tumor, it bleeds, because this confirms that it is a vascular tumor. It is a friable tumor, you see. Trying to catch something to send to Dr. Abu Farsakh at his lab, it's very friable, but very vascular at the same time. And I don't see the structures behind. I don't see the thalamus striate, I don't see the septal, I don't see the caudate. Here I discovered foramen of Monroe by just looking around. So the tumor is centered around foramen of Monroe. Again, I'm just showing you this to make the correlation, because this is the theme of the lectures, the correlation between radiology and pathology. Friable tumor, vascular tumor. It is obstructing foramen of Monroe completely.
Have you thought of embolizing it before
surgery? No, no. It's not the kind of thing that needs embolization. Embolization also has its own side effects if you use it not carefully.
And what kind of reoccurrence rate is this tumor?
Of this? About 20%. So this is the foramen of Monroe. We opened the foramen of Monroe. And we make sure that there's no bleeding, because the blood in the ventricle will cause hydrocephalus. That's why we put the external vein, and we keep it passed up. Because yes, we remove the tumor, and we open the foramen of Monroe, but still there is more tumor to remove. So here's bipolar to remove the last piece. I don't use the bipolar on the surface of the tumor, on the attachment, so that when I send this to the lab, Dr. Farsakh and Dr. Anab and any others would see fresh tissues. So here we are looking at some blood in the ventricle. We suck it out, we keep washing, so that this is the choroid plexus at the choroid fissure on the right side. So here we are, and I want now to open the septum lucidum, so that I will communicate the two ventricles. Here is the septum lucidum, and I want to open it. I open it now, so I communicate both ventricles. So if one is obstructed, the other will function. So I don't need to put two shunts like the mediocre surgeons do. I looked and there's this calcification here, which I did not remove because it is calcified. So this is the end of the surgery. We keep washing because we should leave no blood in the ventricle. Blood in the ventricle cause hallucination, confusion. I think a couple of weeks ago we've done colloid cyst and people in the ICU have seen the patient being confused and thrashing about. Blood in the ventricle is very irritating. So, histopathology. Oops.
This was really very interesting and difficult case. I didn't know all the history till now. The only thing that I received the frozen section and I received this tumor. I want to show you this is the gross of the specimen. If you remember in the video of the operation, we had Dr. Ibrahim took a big piece, and this is the big piece that was taken. You can see this is pusillated, lobulated lesion. You can see the grooves between it. This was about 2 centimeters. This is the biggest piece, and there are some other pieces. And this is the color of it. It's dark brown. Next slide. This was actually a strange tumor. I didn't know also that was in the foramen of Monroe till I reached to the diagnosis that this is SIGA or subependymal germ cell astrocytoma. Once you diagnose SIGA, you cannot retract from it because you are committed to call this patient tuberous sclerosis. And I didn't know that actually he has tuberous sclerosis till today. This is the lesion. You can see that there are spindles of cells in fascicular pattern, goes in fascicular patterns, and they are large cells. They are large, but not giant cells. But they look ugly now somehow for when you start looking at them. And there are some liposytic changes in here, and probably some microcysts. Some of them are liposites, some of them are microcysts. And giving the history, next slide, giving the history, you can see this is like microcystic areas. You can see granular bodies. And this is unusual to see granular bodies in SIGA, but given the history, it has been discovered 10 years before the operation. The granular bodies indicate that this is usually chronic, slow growing tumor. Can occur usually in bilocytic astrocytomas and some other slowly growing tumors like BTX. So this, looking at this, you know that probably you are, although the cells look somehow bad, and there are some mitotic figures we'll show you, probably think, well, these usually occur in low-grade tumors, so I have really to calm down and look very carefully and not to jump into malignant diagnosis. The cells, as you can see, very importantly, they look like ganglion-like cells. They are large, it looks like ganglions, and with eccentric nuclei and very prominent nucleoli. And the overall architecture will make sure that probably I'm looking at a very ancient tumor. That's why the cells have ancient changes and why they should look like ugly, but they are not actually ugly. Next slide. You can see areas. It's very vascular tumor, as Dr. Ibrahim pointed out, and vascular, and this is areas of hemorrhage. And this hemorrhage will suddenly expand the tumor, and probably this why the patient went into hydrocephalus or hydrocephalus suddenly, because there was a hemorrhage. Hemorrhage in these tumors will cause sudden enlargement and blocking what was not blocked. Next slide. You can see I took many pictures of this tumor because it's a rare tumor. Probably this is the second that I have seen in my life. Usually this is a tumor and this is the normal tissue and it's well delineated. This gives you very good indication that probably you are dealing with benign tumor. And these are the ganglion-like large cells, not giant cells. And these are the granular body with liposytic changes. Liposytic changes can be seen in long-standing tumors. Usually in the literature, this is not described much in SIGA. The SIGA is a rare tumor, because most of the time it's operated early on. But this patient has this tumor for many years. Next slide. You can see again, this is slide, you can see many liposytic changes. The spindle and vascular pattern, they go in one line. And you can see here what mimic maybe ependymoma. And this is one of the features of the tumor. These are the tumor cells arrange themselves around blood vessels, and these are the fibrillary cells extending themselves into the blood vessels. This mimic ependymoma, but they are not quite right for ependymoma. But it comes in the differential when you look at them in the histology. Next slide. You can see there are some large cells, very large cells, but not really multinucleated giant cells. And there are some mitotic figures. I think I put some of them here. But you can see the cells, they look like ganglion-like cells with many fibrillary background. Next slide. Again, here, more of the histology of the same thing with granular bodies. This is, again, blood vessel that you can see the cells are arranged around them like ependymoma, but not quite right for ependymoma. Next slide. This is mitotic figure. It was actually not uncommon to see mitotic figure in this case, and I counted them about four mitotic figures per 10 high power feed, which is high for benign tumors. And when you see mitotic figures actually in the brain tumors, you become very much alarmed. But when you get the right diagnosis, you can, because mitotic figures usually jump the tumor into grade 4. And this was a dilemma. Usually, when you see mitotic figures in grade 1, you have to differentiate whether it's actually grade 1 or grade 4, because it makes a lot of difference. And when you make a right diagnosis, you can see that mitotic figures can be seen in SIGA, and they are not really of importance. So this is very, the most important thing is to sort the diagnosis and to see what are the features that make it benign or malignant, and not to be overcome by the usual malignant features that we see in brain tumors. So mitotic figures in brain tumors usually is bad sign, but not in SIGA. SIGA doesn't really carry as much importance. This again, you can see the ganglion-like cells, they look ugly actually when you see them the first time. Next slide. You can see areas of hyalinization because of the chronicity and liposytic changes. Next slide. Again, you can see these are the liposytic changes. They are hypocellular with hypercellular areas in this tumor. Next slide. We resort to immunohistochemistry to confirm this rare diagnosis. This is non-specific enolase, neuron-specific enolase. You can see it stains some of the cells because I wanted to be sure whether these are ganglion cells or not ganglions. But when they stain them, you take ganglion cells stained are with NSE or neuron-specific enolase. So we did another stain, which is cyanoptophysin, which was negative. We'll show you. This is Giemsa stain. Giemsa stain, I did it exactly in this tumor to see the mast cells. Giemsa stains highlight the mast cells. And this is when I suspected this tumor, I have to see mast cells. Mast cells usually are not easily seen by the usual H&E stain. So I have to resort to Giemsa stain. And you can see a lot of mast cells. These are brown, are mast cells or dark magenta cells. And this makes you probably with an add-on feature of this is one of the SIGA features in these tumors. Next slide. I did JFAB. JFAB is positive in astrocytic origin tumors. And you can see they are actually multifocal batchy positive cells. So these cells are positive, most of them for JFAB. And this is not usual for ganglion cells, but although the histology is more of ganglion. Next slide. I did multiple pictures of GFAB for astrocytic, and you can see it's multiple and multifocal. And in these areas, it's not staining, it's in these areas. And this is typical of this tumor. Next slide. This is cyanoptophysin because NSE was positive. I have to do a confirmation test whether these are ganglion cells or not ganglion cells. Cyanoptophysin is completely negative in this tumor cells. So I know these are for sure, they are not ganglion cells. These are of astrocytic origin. Next slide. This S100, it was positive in some of cells, and this is usual with these tumors. Next slide. EMA, it can be positive in dot-like shape, but it was negative in this tumor. Also, this is compatible with this tumor. We do usually K67, and you remember we have mitosis, but when we do K67, usually it's 1 to 2%, and this was 1% in this tumor, indicating that the progression is really low. So and this is all would come together that this is a benign tumor, WHO grade 1, subependymal giant cell astrocytoma. And I pointed out, because this was not known to have really tuberous sclerosis, so I wrote it in the comment, tuberous sclerosis should be considered in this patient.
Thank you. So again, here, this just shows you that the immune staining, the markers that we have seen, is an essential part of the diagnosis. Insurance companies would not like you to do that, because this is extra money, but you should insist on doing them. And should a neurosurgeon know these slides? Of course they should. In fact, they are part of the exam. In the American exam or the French exam, you would have slides of histology. What is this tumor? Because you should know. So postoperative course, here she is, lively and functioning. Here we're looking at the eye movements. No pyramidal signs, mobilized. Further recovery.
You took the external shunt?
Yes.
Right?
We kept it 2-3 days, make sure that there is no blood blocking, and we removed it. So no shunt, basically. Immediate postoperative images. We have done a good job. We still have the calcification on the other side, which is there, but we left it. We are not interested in it. So many of these calcifications are there. And this is the discharge summary. Discharge summary. Not one single piece of paper having 2-3 lines. Patient admitted, operation done, patient bye-bye. This is what is written usually in the discharge summary. It should be like this, telling everything about the patient, and this course in hospital, his surgery, his images, recommendations, consultations, etc. And at that time, my resident was Dr. Mahmoud Nisa. Mahmoud Nisa are around, yes?
Yes.
Mahmoud Nisa is now a full-fledged neurosurgeon. This is the patient, again visiting me in my clinic after that. So she did very well.
Now, she has something in her lips.
Yes, part of the adenoma situation. She's 18 years, but she's mentally retarded. She behaves like a boy of 8 or 10. Mm-hmm. Now, this is, it will take you a few minutes, but this is the very interesting piece. This is a Jordanian family with the 3 sons affected by tuberous sclerosis. Let me take you back to 1988. It is the year, 1 year before I got married.
Usually, so who's the carrier, the mother or the father?
I will tell you. But I wanted to say that I remember 88 because this is 1 year before I got married. Usually you remember the year you got married with the fraud. Okay. This is the family, the elder brother, the middle brother, the younger brother. What happens? 88, this boy had an arrest, hydrocephalus arrest. He was seen by a pediatrician, Dr. Sabagawi, in Markham. He checked him to hospital and then forwarded him to me. Immediately we did a scan, we found the hydrocephalus, so we dealt with it. So I'll go through that. That's his CT 88. We did not have MRI then. Look at this huge tumor, according to this huge hydrocephalus. I did not put a shunt. 88. The last shunt I put maybe 1 or 2 over the last 35 years. A good shunt is no shunt. Remove the cause and you are done. So we took him to theater, removed the tumor. Of course, he still has these subependymandules. We're not interested in these. We're interested in this SIGA, the tumor which caused obstruction. We did not put a shunt. That's my important point. And we did not give radiotherapy because I felt I removed the tumor completely. I will just watch these tubercles and see how it goes. So, 88, following surgery, every year, almost every year, he had this. And these did not change. A little bit of changes, a little bit of tubercles. 2008. And beyond, of course. Up till now, I'm following them. But I mean, radiologically. At that time, because I realized this is tuberous sclerosis, I said, bring the whole family. I got the father, who had CT scan, which was normal. The mother had CT scan, she has tuberculosis. So the mother is the carrier of the disease. She transmitted that to her sons. 3 sons. And this is the elder brother, sorry, it is on the other side. At that time, the CT scan was here is the right. And this is the middle, and this is the young. The young had tubercles, but no tumors. These two, they had their tumors on the left side, which is fine. Two sons, tuberous sclerosis, Sega, inside the ventricle, on the left side. So I got the middle brother. He has a tumor, causing hydrocephalus. So I operated upon him and followed him all these years.
Did you do any genetic workup on this?
Yes, I sent him for genetic counseling at the University of Jordan. This is the youngest brother. This is initial CT scan, and this is the same year, and this is 2008. No changes. I also followed the mother. She had more of these tubercles. You know, she's a carrier with tubercles, which increase in size, but no tumors. So that shows you not all patients with tuberous sclerosis would develop this EGA. And this is the father who remained well. This is them as youngsters. This is them as adults. It fills me with pride to see that I have followed these patients, operated upon them. I did not give them radiotherapy. It was unnecessary. And it's a source of joy for me. And we published this paper, which is very rare, to have these three sons or three members of the family with tuberous sclerosis having these tumors. It was published that this is one of the reference papers in the topic of tuberous sclerosis. Any questions? Please.
More than a question, really a comment. I think you had presented a very elegant presentation, like usually. Every Wednesday I come here, I learn. When I don't come here, I lose many days of my life. Because this is a pediatric disease mostly, pediatrician, we should really look more into that, especially that now we're seeing more autistic patients. And it is reported that one third of patients with autism have
some kind of
sclerosis. Another thing that these three kids, it was reported in April 49, 2 years after, 1 year after 48. So you remember, there were also in three kids and three boys that they had a retinal. So congratulations, after 70 years, we have heard of that. So we should really look as pediatricians when we do exam, mainly to the skin, and really look into many organs and do the test and ask for family history and do what we need.
Thank you very much. Any comments? Sure.
Dr. Ibrahim, thank you for these cases. We often see these cases, but we are lucky that it is rare, because it's a very bad disease. When you have one child of this mentally retarded, seizure non-stop. Even the family, one of the family, they stopped treating one of their children. We don't want to treat them like that.
Sure.
And what is peculiar about our Jordanian, Palestinian kids, they have only neurological case. They don't have any skin, which is 90% of the cases, because it is at the age of 8 years to have this baby to be arrested with hydrocephalus. And previously, there is no headache, no any signs of intracranial pressure that is increased. It's strange.
Yeah.
Because of this, in this, for our pediatrician, any headache, if a patient complains, we have to take it very seriously.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Any our genetic is different?
No. These patients that I showed, the young girl, the 18-year-old girl living in Saudi Arabia, she had adenomasipation. She was mentally retarded, and she had seizures.
Yes.
So you have the three components. Nobody just looked at it. And that shows you. I remind you that a slowly growing tumor like this one, it can grow into huge size, an orange size, without patient complaining. Meningiomas come like this. They say, only I have just complained of headache last week. And the tumor is there for 20 years, because it is slowly growing. So any headache for three consecutive days, or intermittently for 2 months, deserves MRI, not CT. Go for the best. Go for the ultimate. Don't go for a CT half-heartedly. Any questions?
Ibrahim, thank you very much.
everybody is commenting on pediatricians. They have to open their eyes and think carefully on their patients. My question is, did you screen the family of your patient?
The Saudi one? Yes, I did. Yes, I did. But they refused to do it here. They did it in Saudi Arabia, and I don't know the result. But I asked them to go for genetic counseling.
And
they were actually relatives, the father and the mother.
Yes. The other thing that for us as pediatricians that we can do, if we have a family history, we can do antenatal diagnosis by amniocentesis and chromosomal analysis.
True. This disease can be treated in utero.
Yes. And what we can see as pediatricians is mainly the cutaneous changes that can lead us to think of the diagnosis. I have seen only one patient in my lab in maybe 99, and when the family saw all the tubercles and they just disappeared.
If we miss one patient, that's too many.
Yes, it is.
Any other questions or comments? Please, Dr. Mamoutlu.
Did the family, the mother or the kids had seizures?
The family, Jordan family,
yes.
Or this, or the family?
No,
Jordan family, no.
No,
the three kids, they had epilepsy and mental retardation and adenoma separation. So the three kids had the three triads.
And the mother did not have anything?
Mother did not have anything, father was normal. Question here,
please. I'm a radiologist. حبيت بس
هيثم العزام
حبيت اركز على شغلتين واحده غير قابله للنقاش اللي هي الهيستوري اوف ذا بيشنت لما المريض يروح على التصوير او على الراديولوجي يعني يكون لو هذا المريض شفنا قديش في ديفرنشال دايجنوسيس لو انذكر في انه في عنده ايبيليبسي او عنده سكين راشز او سكين ديزيز على طول بقول انا هذا توبيروس سكلروسيس اما اذا ما بنحكي الكلام هذا راح احط حالي في متاهه واحط الكلينيشن كمان في متاهه وبجوز اخر ما افكر فيه التوبيروس سكلروسيس هاي شغله الشغله الثانيه
خليني تو كومنت اون ذيس بوينت فور ذا يونج جنريشنز يو جاست رايت برين ام ار اي جاست انه يو شودنت It should be full. In London, if we could not write the full history and the examination, the thing was refused. Write your findings. Write hemiplegia, the story, sudden, etc. Don't just write brain MRI. For what reason? What are you suspecting? Put them down.
النقطة الثانية هي قابلة للنقاش. يعني هذه تكررت عدة مرات وهي حقيقة إنه no shunt, the best.
The best shunt is no shunt.
Is no shunt. هلا ال إحنا لما يجي عندنا مثلا مريض أو يسأل جيت على البلد هون 93 كنت في محل أكاديمي يعني فما كانش في عندنا أي مشكلة بأنه أي طبيب يتكلم أي شيء لما جينا لهون صارت فيه المشاكل تبدأ أنه أنت ليش تتدخل في شغلنا سواء البيدياتريشن سواء الجاينيكولوجيست سواء أي واحد ثاني فأنت خلاص أنت أكتب شو الدياجنوسيس وما تحكيش مع المريض ولا كلمة هذا الكلام طبعا كان مرفوض هلا في يعني هل ممكن للطبيب هي في نقاش لازم يكون عن المجتمع الطبي كله سواء نقابة سواء وزارة سواء كونفرنس زي هيك إنه لما يكون إحنا لما نشوف الغلط أو أي طبيب يشوف غلط أو شيء إجراء ممكن ينعمل له زي مثلا شنط أشوف تيومر وعامل أوبستراكشن لازم يشال التيومر هذا مشان يروح الأوبستراكشن في مريض يحط شنط هل يحق للطبيب أو من الأفضل إنه الطبيب يدل المريض ويقول له إنك أنت لا تعمل شنط مش إذا عمل شنط تقول له أنت يا دكتورك عمل غلط لا هذا الكلام مرفوض لكن هل ممكن إنه يدله ولا لا شكرا
أتمنى لو كان دكتور مؤمن حديدي موجود he's مسؤول عن هالشغلة بس straight forward I would say yes من رأى منكم منكرا فليغيره إذا ضلنا كلنا ساكتين على الأغلاط الشنيعة احنا نتكلم على التقدم أنا بدي أحكي بالعربي مش أنا لأن أنا ترانسميتينج أبرود نتكلم عن التقدم الطبي الأردني حقيقة في عنا تخلف طبي أردني للأسف في ممارسات واضح إنها سيئة بس لا حسيبة ولا رقيب لا وزارة صحة ولا نقابة الطب ولا أي جمعية تتدخل في المغالطات الجرائم الطبية التي ترتكب we have to admit that and we have to fight it
sorry, too.
صار انه اذا حكينا للمريض it's not documented and it can be المريض ممكن يحكي مش على I think it should be written in the report.
Sure.
But not verbally.
Surely.
This is my
yes. This is my conclusion.
Opinion.
This is my person. I am entitled for my person.
This way, he did correct, and it's written, and it's legal. And it's
if we have,
verbal.
If we have all gathered around the patient, what is the diagnosis? I would come with the diagnosis. You would come with the diagnosis. Another one would come. We are entitled for our opinion. So we just say it. But to keep silent about the crimes. That happens every minute of the day is not good. Kunda said Dr. Tuberous.
Thank you very much. Do you think that the sick happens only in the tuberculosis can be happened in normal population and with the person?
Very, very little. I think 2-3% of cases can happen outside tuberculosis. So it is almost exclusively a tuberculosis case. But some cases have been reported in normal patients. Dr. Mahmoud Al-Assad? ENT, I don't know who will be so well now.
وهذه بتلامت بتقابلنا كثير اللي هي سياسه فنيه هذا بعثنا لكم اياه كنيورو سيرجن قلتم ما في سبب في البرين للهايبرتنشن احنا بنرقعه من الام برد يرجع ثاني لانه في عنده بريشر واتس يور سوليوشن
So about talking about the treatment of increased intracranial pressure, benign increased intracranial pressure, right? One of the, Dr. Ammar, can you help us here? What is the treatment of benign intracranial hypertension?
Well, it depends on which stage patient.
Dr. Ammar Umadi, neurologist?
It depends if the patient came to you early. Probably we'll go for CSF. We just tap around 30 to 50 ml of CSF, and then and usually we videotape the patient prior to the procedure and after the procedure and see any change in his gait, especially the apraxic or march of deep bar gait that usually patient have. If there is improvement in the gait, this is an indication for shunting. If there is no improvement, there is no indication for shunting. Usually, patients comes too late to us, actually. And we do the LP, no improvement, so he's beyond any treatment. Otherwise, we don't have any other option except to diagnose him as early as possible so as to shunt him.
Shunt here is a thecoperitoneal shunt from the lumbar theca,
yeah.
Lumbar neural sac, to the peritoneum and not a shunt.
Yes.
Oh, that, of course, that's not your business. You could see why he's for
that. هلا في ناس بقول لك if you if it has increased intracranial pressure or not if there is CSF leak
sure.
How anybody can measure the intracranial pressure
sure.
في إشي قاعد منفس
sure.
كيف بدي أقيس
pressure sure.
إذا لما يكون ما فيش أي سبب لا traumatic ولا old injury ولا tumors ولا أي إشي خالص أنا بدي مساعدة أنا أعمل له الديورابلاستي بدون ما يكون في ديكريز
true.
شكرا
شكرا any other questions or comments دكتور صالح عجلوني as a pediatric neurologist
والله شكرك على ما خليتناش حكي
لا I want to know if you have any experience
بالنسبة للدكتورة حكيت قبل شوي إنه يعني بجوز الجينيتيك باك جراوند تبع الأربس مختلفة إحنا عادة بنشوف skill manifestations but sometimes it is late وفي ناس كتير براجعوا عند الديرماتولوجيست عشان الادينوما سيبيشيوم وthey don't know انه this is tuberous sclerosis so high index of suspicion is very important في الحالات هاي neurocutaneous syndromes
دكتور احمد حليله do you see these cases في الريدولوجي
no
who else would like to comment Dr. Ibrahim Sadat, pulmonologist, you see these hematomas?
Ibrahim, every limbus is available at Kingfisher Medical Center.
Okay, but as I said, it is FDA approval, so it's good.
We use it since long time.
Is it useful?
Yeah, it is.
So it decreases the size, but it does not cause it to vanish?
No, it doesn't.
And it is long life treatment. Is it expensive?
Well, I don't know. It's free.
Okay, any more questions or comments? Please, some question here.
Comment is here, you know, the microphy any lesion in the brain and increasing day by day or month by month should be, astrocytoma should be suspected.
Absolutely. Okay, if we finish that, thank you. And next Wednesday, we will give you a presentation about Clive.